You can support In the Past Lane by buying some of our merchandise, like shirts, hoodies, mugs, and stickers. Just go to our website, inthepastlane.com. Thanks. In September 1767, rumors of an impending slave insurrection swirled around the port city of Wilmington, North Carolina. The fear had been triggered by word that as many as 20 escaped slaves were lurking in the surrounding county. In response, local officials raised a posse of heavily armed men who set off to track down the alleged rebels. They subsequently captured several men and brought them back to Wilmington, whereupon they were hanged and decapitated. To send a chilling and lasting message to the local enslaved population, town leaders placed the heads on tall posts for all to see. Thereafter, locals called the location Negro Head Point. You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
We the people of the United States, in order to form a more...
Your huddled masses yearning to breathe
consider
free.
Consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill.
That all men and women are created equal.
Give me liberty or give me death.
Nobody's free until everybody's free.
The government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
History matters because it's not just about the past. History's about us, here and now. It explains the world we live in and why things are the way they are. And history gives us insights into how to achieve a more just, peaceful, and prosperous future. So people, let's do this. Hello there, everyone. Welcome to In the Past Lane, the podcast about American history and why it matters. I'm host Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, and this is In the Past Lane, episode 97, in which we look at the long history of race, place, and memory in a southern city. We are coming to you this week from the Grandfather Clause Studios, located in central Massachusetts. You can learn more about me, this podcast, and our guests at our website, inthepastlane.com, and on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and our YouTube channel. Frequently scaring the living daylights out of us is our executive producer, Lulu Spencer. So what's happening in the Past Lane this week? Well, here in New England, the days are getting shorter, temperatures are dropping, and my mighty Red Sox are preparing for the playoffs. At my college, I'm teaching a seminar on America in the Gilded Age. Tomorrow's class is about the labor movement, so there'll be lots of discussion about strikes and critiques of laissez-faire capitalism, and maybe a little of my guy, Henry George. Also, I'm working on some awesome new episodes, including, wait for it, a conversation with the great Jill Lepore about her latest amazing bestseller, These Truths, A History of the United States. But wait, there's more. I'll also speak with another fabulous historian, Joanne Freeman, about her new bestseller, The Field of Blood, Violence in Congress and the Road to Civil War. Other future episodes include ones on the great influenza epidemic of 1918-1919. This is the 100th anniversary, of course. The Eugenics Crusade of the early 20th century, and a conversation with Stephen Brumwell about his new biography of America's most infamous traitor, Benedict Arnold. Plus a whole lot more. In other news, this is episode 97, so that can only mean one thing. Episode 100, the mighty century mark, is right around the corner. Zounds. That is a big deal, at least in the podcasting world. Many people think if you hit the 100 episode mark, you're very likely to avoid what's called pod fading, which is that you just run out of gas, run out of time, run out of energy to keep your podcast going. So we're almost at the 100 episode mark, and as far as I'm concerned, it's full steam ahead. Well, all of this podcast making is made possible by the generous support of you listeners who send, via Patreon or PayPal, a monthly contribution, ranging from as little as $1 a month, basically 12 bucks a year, to as high as $10 a month. Now, this monthly support is awesome because it allows me to pay someone to edit and assemble one episode per month. That saves me about 7 to 8 hours per week. And that's a big deal in my case because I have a real job as a history professor that easily takes up 70 hours a week. So to all of you patrons, I say thank you, thank you, thank you. But, of course, more support would be great. My goal is to reach a level of support that will allow me to pay for 2 episodes to be edited per month. So if you're able to part with as little as $1 a month, you can join the team of supporters by heading over to our website, inthepastlane.com, and clicking on the support button. Thanks. All right, enough talk of money. Let's get to this episode's main feature, my interview with historian Meg Mulrooney about her new book, Race, Place, and Memory, Deep Currents in Wilmington, North Carolina. Okay, people, I'm driving. Who wants to ride shotgun? Your journey in the past lane begins now. For the past 2 weeks, Wilmington, North Carolina has been in the news a lot. And that's because this picturesque tourist destination on North Carolina's Atlantic coastline has borne the brunt of Hurricane Florence and its devastating floodwaters. But 120 years ago, in the fall of 1898, Wilmington, North Carolina made national headlines for a very different reason. It was the scene of a very dark event in American history. In the 2 decades leading up to November 1898, the period of U.S. history we know as Reconstruction, African Americans in Wilmington had made the most of the freedom that they'd gained in the wake of the Civil War. Many of them had become literate and acquired jobs and property, and they also gained political power by forming an alliance with poor and working-class whites. But these modest gains by African Americans were eventually challenged by a rising tide of violent white supremacy that swept the South beginning in the mid-1870s. And so it was in the fall of 1898 that white supremacists in Wilmington, North Carolina, carried out a massacre of scores of African Americans and then marched on City Hall to stage the only recorded coup d'etat in U.S. history, forcing at gunpoint the city's mayor, city council, and police chief to resign. Well, this incident occupies a key place in a new book by historian Meg Mulrooney, Race, Place, and Memory, Deep Currents in Wilmington, North Carolina. Coming up in a moment, I'll speak with her about the 1898 massacre and coup, and how it fits into a centuries-long story of the interplay of race, place, and memory in a southern city. Don't go anywhere, people. In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters, we'll be right back. All right, back at In the Past Lane, and with me now is historian Margaret M. Mulrooney. Meg, as her friends refer to her, is professor of history and associate vice provost of university programs at James Madison University. She is the author of 2 books, Black Powder, White Lace, The DuPont Irish and Cultural Identity in 19th Century America, and her latest work, Race, Place, and Memory, Deep Currents in Wilmington, North Carolina. Meg Mulrooney, welcome to In the Past Lane.
Thanks, good to be here.
Well, I want to begin by asking you to explain to our listeners how you came to this topic. From what I understand, it initially started out as a public history commemoration of a really dark chapter in American history, but that in turn led you to write this book, which examines not just one event, but several centuries of history, focusing on the interplay of 3 themes which you identify as race, place, and memory. So could you start by telling us the origin story of this book and how these 3 themes emerged?
So I was working at UNC Wilmington as folks were getting ready for a centennial commemoration of the so-called 1898 race riot. And the book really came about because I wanted to understand the dynamics that were happening in the city at that time in the late 1990s, which I think a lot of your listeners probably know was a fairly contentious time so far as the culture wars and the history wars were sort of cresting at that time. So I wanted to understand what was happening in the centennial, which led me, of course, backwards to understanding what actually happened in 1898. And there were multiple and competing interpretations of that event. But what became apparent to me is the way in which that event was embedded within this larger story. In fact, it was embedded within multiple stories that traced really all the way back to the city's origins. So what I naively imagined in, you know, probably around the year 1999, 2000, as an article evolved over time into this larger book, as you say, using Wilmington as a case study. Because what I found is that to understand Wilmington, I also had to put it in this bigger national context. So a lot of the things that happened in Wilmington before 1898, after 1898, and even up to the present are very similar to the kinds of things that are happening all around us. Even today, you know, when you look at communities like Charlottesville that have been so prominent in the public eye. So I went back in time and I needed to, as a good historian, map it chronologically in some ways to see the relationships. And so I found there were a couple of different self-defined traits that came to be for Wilmingtonians in the 18th century. And the way that history was used was very important. That's, of course, the memory piece of it. How was history being created, constructed through place and time? And I was very interested in the way in which history was being attached to the landscape. So that brings me to place, which is, of course, a very important concept both in academic circles, in public history circles, in geography, many other academic disciplines. I wanted to think about the physical aspects, but I also wanted to think about place identity, how people were using history and connecting historical interpretations to, in some cases, physical buildings, but it could also be a place in the landscape. It could be a street name. There was a whole bunch of things there. And then, of course, really, I needed to do a deep dive, and I saw that a sense of race or racial identity was also central to this story and began, of course, in the 18th century. And by the race element, I mean very specifically the construction of whiteness and blackness. You know, who is defined and who's doing the defining and what are the criteria that they used. So all three of these things, race, place, and memory, really got their start much earlier, I think, than people might imagine if they were just looking at the 1998 commemoration. And over time, each of these strands kept bubbling up in different ways. So I trace that through the 18th century. The city becomes essentially a place on the map, as it were, not a very large city.
But an important port city that has kind of a thriving economy that's very much connected to the larger region.
Exactly. It's a very distinctive place, not only in southeastern North Carolina, but in the Carolinas broadly in that colonial context. Very early on, it develops a very large slave market, for example, to feed the rice plantations. And of course, people know that North Carolina calls itself a Tar Heel State, right? So the production of tar and naval stores, that was really the main kind of economic activity that enslaved people were engaged in. So it had a really central role economically, but it also had this important sense of place attached to it. So the elites, as the plantation gentry starts to emerge and solidify their power, they start to invent a particular sense of place-ness, if I can use that term, for the community. They imagine it to be a sort of genteel outpost in some ways.
Yeah. Could you tell us more about how these elites began to project their aspirations literally onto the landscape by erecting structures that evoked their economic power, but also by naming places in the city that projected their social power, particularly their social power over the enslaved?
Well, they start marking the landscape with courthouses and market houses and coffee houses and things of that sort. But at the same time, there are these other places, and the one that I particularly call attention to is historically called Negro Head Road, where a group of enslaved rebels were captured and beheaded, and their heads were placed as monuments. Those physical monuments didn't last, but the place name stayed, and it became a place that was used for other kinds of very gruesome monuments. So this sort of tension is one of the key themes in the book, how race and place and memory, again, are all interconnected. And this pattern continues as you move into the antebellum period with the emergence of railroads supplementing the historic river and the expansion of an urban middle class, really, that we don't often think of when we think about southern cities, but were very essential to the development of Wilmington as a port city. Cotton starts to make its appearance in addition to rice and naval stores. So you have some transformations. You start getting more manufacturing taking place.
Yeah, it's a far more urban, far more, almost like a mini Baltimore, so to speak. It's got much more of a capitalist industrial feel than one would associate with antebellum Southern notions, the antebellum South's notions of itself, particularly Wilmington's, the way that they think of themselves later as this genteel Southern city.
Right, right. And we know a lot about what that looked like in cities like Charleston or Richmond or New Orleans, but it's important to note that this is happening in other southern cities as well during that period. So you have individuals who are buying enslaved labor and putting them to work in industrialized settings. So they are fully incorporating the system of slavery into this transforming, industrializing, market-oriented economy at the same time that they're trying to reinforce their connections to the past.
Right. You point out in particular their connections to the American Revolution and the founding period and how their version of the revolution supported an emerging Southern nationalism and eventually secession.
Right. It's in that antebellum period that the white elites start to invent an identity for themselves as American patriots. harking back to the Stamp Act rebellion that took place in Wilmington. They claim to have the earliest Stamp Act rebellion, so they start commemorating that in the antebellum period. They position a Revolutionary War cannon in a public location near the waterfront. They commemorate the Battle of Moore's Creek. So it's a very conscious effort, but it's a very selective interpretation of the past that helps them make sense of their present and the transformations that are happening there.
Right, connecting them to a glorious past as they charge into the future.
Absolutely. They construct this sense of their history, their heritage is really the word that I should use, as being proudly anti-tyrannical, you know, very pro-local rights. And of course, white supremacist is bound up in that and elitist. And they will use that same rhetoric. They will use that heritage when the sectional crisis begins and exaggerate it all throughout the Civil War, which, of course, they are casting as another rebellion or revolution against a tyrannical government. You know, and this time, instead of arguing for local rights, they're arguing for states' rights. So a lot of the themes that, again, begin in the colonial period get, shall we say, resurrected?
Yeah, resurrected and rebooted.
Yeah, rebooting is a good word for it. So, you know, it continues along. The Civil War, of course, is devastating for the Southern white elite in Wilmington, as much as it benefits other populations, particularly the enslaved. So Reconstruction is very difficult for everybody concerned.
Right. In those decades leading up to 1898, the Reconstruction, you describe them as sort of an uneasy coexistence between whites and blacks and newcomers and longstanding citizens and so forth. And you also point out that out of this newly freed African-American population, there develops a black middle class, because the black population in this city is pretty substantial. And you highlight one particular individual, Frederick Sedgwick.
Yeah.
Who's a skilled woodworker and raises a big family and scrapes and saves and sends the kids to college. It's a real success story in that regard. But there's other things happening at that same time that are moving against that kind of liberty and that kind of, you know, the ability for people like Frederick Sedgwick to make their own way with their newly found freedoms.
Right. And the Sedgwick family is prominent in key parts of the book. And so in the Reconstruction period, those kinds of individuals and their families form the basis of this new black middle class that begins to solidify and expand in some important ways in the Reconstruction period. But as we know, by the end of Reconstruction, there is a virulent backlash as protections are removed, as federal troops leave the region, and that process accelerates as you move into the 1880s.
And as you point out, part of this backlash is aimed at the political power that African Americans have gained through forming a coalition with white working class allies. And these people are inspired by the populist movement that's going on nationally at the time. And broadly speaking, this is a movement that opposes entrenched elite power and favors progressive social and economic policies that are designed to favor the poor and working class people. And in Wilmington, this multiracial coalition, they call themselves fusionists, enjoys a lot of political success in the 1890s. So can you tell our listeners more about this populist fusionist movement and how white Democrats and powerful business interests eventually moved to overthrow it?
So yeah, in the city, you have a number of formerly rural white working class individuals who have, you know, relocated to the city for jobs. And they form this, you know, again, emerging coalition with black Republicans. So these new coalitions, that fusion movement, they take control of the city government, and the white Democratic Party begins to mobilize to put that to a dramatic end. But I want to say that the perceptions of fusionist power and black power in Wilmington were misunderstood in some important ways. An earlier historian, Helen Edmonds, did a landmark study, and she was the first, as an African-American historian, to document and say, well, yes, they had moved into a lot of positions, but they didn't really have power because of the way the city government was set up. But what was important was the perception that they had power. They had more positions than they had ever had before, and that was sufficient to set the white supremacist Democratic Party platform moving in a new direction. Now, in Wilmington, as we get closer to the context of the November 1898 massacre and coup, which is the proper language, I would argue,
As opposed to race riot, which...
As opposed to race riot, yeah. And we can talk about, again, the way some of the language has been used and misused around this event and other kinds of events.
So let's get to the massacre and coup of November 1898. It's long been misrepresented, as we just noted, as a race riot. It's also, according to your research, been misunderstood as a coup and massacre that was essentially masterminded by a single group of white supremacists. But your book argues something different. Tell us more about that.
So I make a couple of slightly different arguments than the standard version of the event. So I think most people would understand that today, I think most of your listeners would understand that this was a white supremacist event engineered by prominent Democrats at the state level. That's kind of the dominant interpretation of this event, that they attacked a largely unarmed black civilian population and then effected a coup, which is believed to be, by some people, the only documented coup d'etat in the United States. But when you look at the local sources, and especially the local individuals, I think the story is actually a little bit more complex. The individuals who were responsible for organizing and effecting the violence as well as the coup were actually not prominent players in the Democratic Party, either at the local level or the state level. And they go down in history under the title of the Secret Nine, which gives them a kind of, you know, sinister quality. But what I argue in the book is that their interests were quite specific. They were interested in boosting their own economic gain. They were interested in redirecting the city's development along a different line than the fusionist government had wanted, but even a different direction than the Democratic Party had wanted. These are prominent businessmen who are very much a product of the New South. They are bringing about the New South, and they see the populist fusionist government as an obstacle in their way.
Right, but before these two groups actually carry out the overthrow of the fusionist government, white supremacists lay the groundwork essentially by stoking white racist animosity in Wilmington. And their pretext is an editorial that was published in a local African-American newspaper that they deemed incendiary and impudent. Tell us more about this incident.
So the editorial is published by Alex Manley, who is the editor of the Daily Record there. And his editorial is a rebuttal to another famous white supremacist editorial. So Manley's editorial comes out in opposition. He's rebutting the idea that black men are, in the language of the day, ravenous beasts intent on raping white women. You know, this is the sort of beginning of the apogee of the trend toward lynching at the late 19th century. And he makes the case that, of course, this isn't accurate at all, that many of the relationships that occur between black men and white women are consensual. And
right, much like Ida B. Wells, roughly at the same time.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And what happens is the white supremacist Democratic city leaders and others in the town decide to use this as a pretext. But when you start peeling away, the plans for the massacre and the coup by the Secret Nine were actually already in place by this point. So they had already set in motion their secret plan. And so the two groups are actually working parallel, but not together. There are only a handful of individuals who know that both groups are trying to do something. And what they're trying to do is, of course, very different. The white Democrats are trying to effect a electoral revolution, as it were, by suppressing the black vote. The Secret Nine are trying to effect a municipal coup d'etat because they know that even if the Democrats win the election in November, that's not actually going to change the political or physical complexion of the individuals running the government until a new city charter can be effected. And they don't want to wait, which is why the coup becomes actually pretty important.
Yeah, so for white supremacist Democrats, they put all their energy into winning the election. And as you point out, they use every down and dirty trick in the book to boost their chances. So ultimately, what happens in this election?
Well, so the election, you know, thanks to the Democrats in the city, there was egregious ballot stuffing, you know, suppression of the vote, intimidation, violence for weeks leading up to the election. So nobody was surprised that the election went the way it did, that it was pretty much a solid win for the white supremacist Democratic platform. So as far as the Democrats were concerned, you know, mission accomplished. Yay. Celebrating,
right.
You know, parade. which is why you get this sense of their shock when they realize that something else is happening.
Right. And the first signal is the carefully orchestrated destruction of the Daily Record, the African-American newspaper published by Alexander Manley. How does this play out?
There is this organized parade, really. It's a procession that starts at the Wilmington Light Infantry on Market Street. It's a demonstration of white supremacist power. So they're using it as a didactic lesson. And again, in the book, I connect these kinds of didactic processions through space and time. This is not a new tactic that they've invented for this moment. It's an old tactic that they're rebooting, to use your word. So they get to the Daily Record office and they knock on the door, you know, to call Alex Manley out to answer for his incendiary editorial. And of course, Manley's gone by this point. He has been alerted. He is likely thinking that his life, he'd already been threatened, but he likely understands that his life is now truly in jeopardy. So he has left the community. And they proceed to ransack the building and pull things out into the street. And the building sort of, you know, mysteriously on purpose gets set on fire. And then they take photographs. So again, I think there are interesting ways in which the violence sets the stage for the violence that's going to come. Most of the violence is done by paramilitary organizations who are under command of the Secret Nine and their cronies. Again, the Democratic Party is not involved in this. The Democratic Party officials and leaders in the community kind of slowly come to realize that there's something else that's been going on all these many months.
And this is where the massacre occurs. Groups of armed whites begin to attack the African-American sections of Wilmington, setting fires, destroying businesses and property, and murdering as many as 60 people. What else do our listeners need to know about these attacks?
So the violence that really starts to ensue is both random, uncoordinated. There are gunshots, and there's one horrifying incident where a black man is dragged from his house and brutally pistol whipped, and then he's forced to run a gauntlet of armed whites who fire on him. And then he's not dead, and his body, you know, has to lay there. You know, just unspeakable acts of cruelty and violence were happening throughout this. But at the same time, you have these paramilitary groups that are riding around and intervening and demonstrating that they have taken control of the city. And again, processions and parades through it. So the violence that happens is only over the space of, I think, maybe 8 hours or so, you know, frightens the hell out of everybody. Hundreds and hundreds of African-American men and women flee the city. They seek shelter in nearby woodlands and really hiding anywhere they can, you know, trying to flee this, believing that their lives are in jeopardy. It takes quite a while, in fact, to persuade people to come back into the city. As a result, the state militia are called in, you know, and so order, quote, is restored pretty much by dusk of the primary day of the violence.
And the Secret Nine will use this violence that they themselves perpetrated as the pretext for the coup.
Yeah, it really comes to a climax in the city hall when members of the Secret Nine, they've called the city council and the mayor together, and they pretty much tell them, well, you have proved yourselves incapable of ending the violence and defending the city. So we're going to take control of the city government.
Right. And so at gunpoint, the coup leaders force the mayor, the city council, and the chief of police to resign.
Yeah. And then they have to start damage control. And so I think that's an interesting piece of the story as well. What happens in the aftermath of the coup? There were allegations. Because of the ballot stuffing, there were allegations against the Republican candidates. This is going to go all the way to the President of the United States. Many individuals, but also many federal agencies, are going to be looking closely at Wilmington. This becomes the dominant news story for many months. The Secret Nine and also the Democrats who were leading the white supremacy campaign were not anticipating the close scrutiny that they received. And this is where then you start getting the new language. So locally, they refer to this as the Wilmington Revolution, quite deliberately, you know, again, as sort of an anti-tyrannical effort against this sort of fusionist, populist government that was, in their minds, an illegal government. And at the same time, they start pushing out the misinterpretation that this was an armed uprising of blacks, a race riot that had to be suppressed.
Right. That's why language is so important in the way it was couched and the way it's been remembered.
Right. And so, you know, to kind of bridge the gap between the actual events of 1898 and then the centennial, it turns out that there were multiple similar kinds of episodes throughout the city's history, particularly in the 20th century, and the memories of 1898 kept getting recirculated and revived and rebooted in some interesting ways. And so that becomes part of understanding what took place during the 1990s.
Right. So why don't we jump to that? Because you show up in Wilmington in 1996, and that's 2 years before the centennial, and it's a difficult event, and not everybody's very excited about commemorating this moment, particularly as the city by then has really fashioned itself in some ways like a mini Charleston at South Carolina. It's got a lot of that Southern charm and vibe, the carriage rides and a real sense of, you know, come and see Southern heritage feel to it. And bringing this up is going to really irk a lot of people at the very least. So tell us, you know, how that struggle played out and what ultimately happened and what we can learn from it as we are 20-something years later.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was surprised myself. You know, I come in a newcomer. I had been hired as a visiting assistant professor to teach U.S. courses and public history specifically. That's really my primary area of expertise. And I was, I think, you know, invited as a new member of the department, someone specializing in public history, to participate in the early stages of the planning for the 1998 commemoration. I didn't know that much about 1898 myself. I had heard of it, certainly, as a U.S. historian, but I had that generic understanding that I described earlier. I really wasn't prepared myself for what I and my students even uncovered in the space of a couple of semesters. So at that time, when I arrived, the dominant narrative in the city was that the 1898 event was a race riot. It was a black uprising that the white elite city fathers had ended. They had saved the city from, quote, Negro domination, right? That was the standard. But additionally, they had said, as part of that narrative, that what happened in 1898 was aberrant. It was unusual, right? Very common kind of an interpretation for cities or towns or even small communities that have some kind of a really violent, traumatic episode. They're always kind of like, well, it was aberrant and it was all a bunch of outsiders.
Outside agitators,
that's right. So yeah, when we start revealing the alternative interpretations, right? We didn't have to invent them. They were already there. They just weren't the dominant official narrative of the city. So once we started revealing some of this, and back to, you know, even Helen Edmonds' work that I mentioned earlier, some of this information had been around for decades and decades and decades. Lots of people knew what had actually happened. It just wasn't the official story.
Right. And that's where you and your students step in to challenge this official, very tidy, very convenient version of the events of 1898. How did that unfold?
So my students and I started working through this. I was also serving as the public historian in residence. That was my title to the early planning group. At that time, it was called the Centennial Foundation. There was not really a good overview of what had happened in 1898. There was a book called We Have Taken a City by an African-American historian, Leon Prather. The book was out of print by that time. Most of the copies that were in libraries were not circulating because, big surprise, people who got their hands on the book tended to make it disappear.
Yes, yes.
So they were in special collections. So one of the first things I was asked to do was write up a kind of very simple, short summary of what had happened. And boy, did that generate a lot of contention in the city. And at the same time, my students were doing a project that also highlighted what had actually happened as opposed to how it had been remembered.
And how were these things being published in the local papers, or were you mounting an exhibition? How were people finding out about it in order to get outraged?
Well, I wrote two summaries. The short summary was the one that particularly generated some consternation. They were posted on a website that the organizers of the Centennial Foundation had created. specifically to inform the public. And there was a bibliography, you know, there's a whole lot of other kinds of things that people could have gone and read, but, you know, they tended to look at that first thing and question the interpretation that I was offering. And in effect, you know, same argument I make in the book, same one that other scholars have made before me, if you actually look at it, there was no Negro domination, you know, as they called it euphemistically, in the city. Yes, there were black men who held public office. Yes, there were black men and women who comprised a sizable middle class, but they didn't have power the way that that phrase suggests, right? So the answer, of course, is racism. You know, the white elites and also the white middle class and the white working class of Wilmington, as in many other communities, simply feared the upward mobility, the transformations that had happened in their communities, and they were seeking to put an end to it. So that's, you know, essentially the case that I made and that my students made. The project that the students did was a walking tour brochure, and it had sites from around the city from different historical periods, but there were several of them that related to the 1898 massacre and coup. And so again, it added to the consternation. And those were the early days. And then as the planning for the commemoration, there were a whole bunch of other events that began to happen in, you know, the space of about a year, year and a half. And almost every single thing, every single kind of activity, whether it was, you know, the speaker series that the foundation organized, or whether it was bringing in outside experts like Kalesa Powell, who came in from New Orleans to talk about African-American tourism. There were so many different things that were being done to try and tell the story and honor the memory and heal the wound. Those were the three taglines for the Centennial Foundation. There were so many ways in which these conflicting interpretations of 1898 kept coming up and coming up.
Right. And in the latter part of your book, you note that there are other incidents in Wilmington's history after 1898 that are similarly misremembered.
Right. What was fascinating, again, to me, and what set me going backwards in time, was the way in which other episodes of racist violence kept also being remembered. So particularly the 1968 riots after Martin Luther King was assassinated. He was actually scheduled to have been in Wilmington on April 5th. So they were particularly vivid memories of the circumstances surrounding his assassination and the riots that took place at that time. People were very familiar with violence that took place in 70 and 71, the circumstances that culminated in the trial of the Wilmington 10. But you could go back in time and you could see there were similar kinds of conflicts, very, very violent conflicts between the white authorities in the community and African Americans asserting their rights during World War II, during World War I, during the 1930s, you know, back before 1898 even. So I was very consciously interested after I left Wilmington, again, trying to understand what had happened during the commemoration years. I was very conscious of trying to go back and understand this pattern of violence. So I want to reiterate that while what happens in 1898 is very important to understanding Wilmington, it's not the only thing. In fact, it fits a pattern.
It's not a one-off.
It is not a one-off.
Right, especially, and in Wilmington's case, it runs counter to the image that they're crafting for themselves and for a larger consumption, which is a racially progressive city.
Yeah.
And that these are rare and exceptional incidents that have many explanations that have nothing to do with what's actually happening in Wilmington. So to expose that certainly does, you can see how that would infuriate people that don't want to hear that. And that leads me to what you write about as the central purpose of your book. Maybe this is a good way to conclude this interview, which is, you mentioned that, you know, your central purpose is to illuminate and mitigate the broader power struggles that affect many public history projects today. So what is it, you know, you've learned a lot in the 1990s and since, and now we live in a very contentious period where you can, you know, as a historian, you can say, I wonder how Charlottesville is going to be remembered in 20 years or 100 years. I wonder what's going to be said about Ferguson. Who's going to grab onto that narrative and who's going to craft the master narrative? Who's going to be left in? Who's going to be given a privileged position? And will people connect the dots? Will people connect Ferguson to Charlottesville and Baltimore and other points of conflict today? So what would you say is the public history lesson takeaway from your experience, and how does that apply to now?
Well, what I ended up arguing is that we need what I called authentic public history projects. I think Wilmington aspired that way. It did a lot of great things to try and be as inclusive as they could, speaking of the Centennial Foundation and its successor organization. We need to have less of the selective, exclusionary, elitist interpretations of history. This goes back to a very old concept in public history work, which I know you know, but this idea of shared authority, that you can't have a successful public history endeavor, like a commemoration, for example. Or, you know, today we would say there are all these questions about monuments, taking some down, putting others up, right? Those are similar kinds of public history projects. You can't have a really successful public history project unless you include all the different groups in a community, and you have to share authority with them. You have to recognize that, you know, when a group of people want to control a project, and it could be that they are contemporary elites who are trying to control the project and the interpretation of the past, but they could also be well-meaning historians, let's say, academics who feel that because of their particular background and training that somehow they should have authority over the final interpretation. So that's really one of my biggest takeaways from this project and others that I've been involved in since. Sharing authority is doing a project like that with, not for, the population of the particular community. So I think that's what we need to be focused on today. Today, I think I'm just particularly struck by the way some of the same language is being used in some communities. Even here in Harrisonburg, Virginia, where I live, you have people who are using this kind of anti-tyranny, pro-local rights kind of language, and they're using history, and they're using a kind of distorted representation of the past to make their case. Again, it's what we saw in Charlottesville, and we've seen it in many other communities, which is why, again, I hope that this book, even though it's focused on Wilmington, I hope that people will see that it is the same story, regardless of what community you're in, this power struggle. But at the same time, I think we're seeing a lot of people who are, they're not always distorting history for an overt purpose. Some of them are victims of what we call historical amnesia. You know, I know you've heard that phrase before, this kind of conscious or deliberate avoidance of accurate history. So for some people, that looks like calls for celebratory or positive or uplifting histories.
Right. Why stir up old wounds? And
yes, exactly. You hear a lot of that kind of rhetoric.
So what's behind this tendency toward distorted memories of the past and historical amnesia?
So the connection is really trying to preserve the status quo about inequality in many of our communities today. So again, I'm firmly convinced that having authentic public history projects that share authority in communities, that work to acknowledge what Jim Horton called the tough stuff of the past, I think we absolutely have to have those kinds of public history projects. In some ways, they are corrective of the distortions that are still out there in many communities. But in other cases, I think they're necessary to kind of challenge people to think about the present, right? There's always that relationship in public history context. How are those interpretations, whether it's a monument or a commemoration, a film, you know, there's many different ways this plays out in communities. How are they preserving hierarchies of power, old hierarchies of power in the present? Well, we can't always answer that unless we see how those hierarchies of power and how those distorted histories have affected us.
Right. And I think we live in an era now where we have some really vivid examples just in the last 18 months or so where the power of history, the power in history is very, very evident. So, well, Meg, this has been a terrific conversation and really interesting. And your book is a great read and a really deep dive into this whole question about commemoration and memory and how history and power are interconnected and how this is not just something from the past. This is something that's playing out right before our very eyes. So thank you very much for taking the time to speak to us at In the Past Lane.
Oh, my pleasure.
Meg Mulrooney is the author of Race, Place, and Memory, Deep Currents in Wilmington, North Carolina, published by the University Press of Florida. Okay, people, that's all for this episode of In the Past Lane. Thank you so much for tuning in. I'm In the Past Lane's host, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, reminding you that history explains our world. So let's pay attention to it. We hope you'll join us next time for another journey in the past lane. Hey, Lulu, I hear that some podcasts are adding listener lines so people can call in. What do you think?
1-800-I-DON'T-GIVE-A-RAT'S-ASS.
SBI, Snoring Beagle International.